All I can ever be to you is the darkness that we know and this regret I got accustomed to.
Thank you for coming. You've come a long way.
It was a long way, really. Yeah, yeah. But it was worth it.
Well, I hope so.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So the first subject I would like to talk with you is about the creativity process of when you just start a book.
Yeah.
And which is your like ignition
in terms of Shakespeare?
Yeah.
Well, I can go back to Shakespeare easily because the first chapter of each section was written from one of Shakespeare's plays, and it gave me the opportunity of exploring Shakespeare's extraordinary munificence in terms of words. And I found that by using his earliest words in the chapters, I was able to create a narrative out of those words.
And how did you balance the fiction and the actual facts in the biographies in general? Because, well, I read that you wrote biographies just for the entertainment, right? It's not like a science paper.
Well, no, it wasn't a science paper in any sense of the word. But what I did try to do was to remain as faithful as anyone could be to the actual surroundings of the man and the period. What I tried to do was recreate, say, 17th century, 18th century, 19th century, so that people might actually belong there or feel that they belong there. And as a result of that, the characters who emerged, real as most of them were, came much more fully to life than I ever imagined. They took part in the theatre of London in the period.
What do you think that the public were looking for when they were attending a Shakespearean play? Because they were almost, well, men like 90% they couldn't write. Or read.
They couldn't write, they couldn't read, but they did like a fight. And they liked jokes. And they liked parody.
Yes, indeed. Well, there were fights between bears and dogs.
Mm.
And they have another kind of entertainment with all these violent punishments, public punishments.
Yes.
But do you think that the text was important there, or like the costume was more important, or just going and take a look at William Kemp?
It
do
was
you think because...
Yeah, it was the genius of Shakespeare to somehow conflate the understandable desire of the public for fighting, comedy, transvesting, all the rest of it, together with some of the most extraordinarily arresting stories. So it was a measure of his majesty that he was able to create difficult plays from very, very low origins.
Who do you think Shakespeare was? Was more like a businessman? Was a bohemian? Who was like
he was
looking for a kind of a status in society?
He was all those things. He was looking for status in society. He was a practical man of the theatre. He lived in the theatre all his life. And he treated it as a job and as a profession. So to think of him as somehow a bohemian, it gives the wrong impression of a man who is dedicated 100% to the success of his theatre and to the success of his contemporaries.
Exactly. And, well, he used to, like we call it now, copy and paste a lot.
Yes, he copied and pasted scenes which he took straight out of other plays. He was well known for it. He was accused of being a plagiarist on many occasions. But that was the way the theatre worked in those days. There was no alternative. There's no copyright. And in the absence of great scripts, it was quite natural for Shakespeare to borrow other examples.
Yeah, and the same as you do, he just plays fiction into biography.
Yeah, I never really see the difference between the two. They both themes to me to be part of the same process. It could be said, for example, that in factual, that you can make stuff up, but in fiction you have to tell the truth. And that's the one line I keep to myself.
So you feel more responsible for the readers than for the actual main character of the book?
Yes, I feel more responsible for the readers to be able to get a proper understanding of the period and the people and of the setting and of the atmosphere and so forth, rather than to create a interesting story.
Right. Well, it's been like 31 years now from Hawksmoor.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a long way. And you've been writing almost like one or two books every year.
Right? That's right. Yes, it's so more or less one
where
now.
Where do you think this pulsion of writing is coming from?
I don't know. It just happens. It's nothing I have ever had any real control over. Once I start one book, it carries on until it finishes. I must say, as I get older, I tend to write one book at a time rather than two books at a time. But the same process, the same urge, the same instinct is still there when I'm writing.
And that process, to me, is like a painful process. It's like something like a sting in my brain. You know, it's like until it's over and I'm relieved.
Yeah.
And then all the friends come to me and say, "Well, now are you happy? It's over. You got your work done." And it's like, "No, I'm not happy. I'm just relieved of that pain." You know. It's like,
well, that's true.
How does it work with you?
I'm not happy because I'm always thinking of the next project. So it's a never-ending process where, when one begins, or when one ends, the other begins.
Yeah.
And somehow they fall upon each other. They follow each other in some strange, mysterious way.
Yeah. And in the whole process, where is the stage that you enjoy more?
The research, I think, is the bit I enjoy most. I would take, say, for example, a book of the length of Shakespeare's, a couple of years to research it, and that, for me, is the most pleasurable part.
Well, for Hawksmoor, you
oh, yes, like another one.
Books and,
yeah, I read Johnson's about...
Johnson's dictionary as well.
I read everything that had been written in that period. As far as I can recall, I did. And as you said, I read Samuel Johnson's dictionary all the way through. And it was that collaboration with the past which helped me to recreate the past in a interesting and intriguing manner.
And when did you decide that the character was going to speak like in those times? You know, like
that came as
a great exercise.
Yeah, that came as an accident, not as an accident, as a sort of intuition. It suddenly occurred to me that that would be the best way of dealing with it. And I started, and I slowly understood the language, the 16th century language, 17th century language, and it became second nature to me, so that I was able to write it with the same fluency as I wrote the 20th century language.
Well, that's amazing.
Well, it's just a habit.
It happened. And you said that you were not comfortable with some passages of that book. And I would like to ask you if you consider it like a rewritten, like Shakespeare will do.
I don't know if I was not comfortable with passages of the book.
Well, in terms of the, you know, the kind of building of the different stages of the novel.
Oh, that didn't matter to me too much. The one thing which did give me trouble was the ending, and that was one which I never really solved. It's always been the problem with that book, because it's several television companies and a couple of film companies have wanted to turn it into a film, but the ending baffles them. There's no way they can use the ending, because it doesn't make any sense, effectively. So I should think if I had my chance to rewrite that, I would put my forces into the conclusion.
The conclusion. In that novel, it started like a circular time.
Yeah.
And, well, I'm coming from Argentina, so my reference is Borges in that matter.
Of course,
yeah. How this translated into the rest of your novels?
Well, they all share a similar sensibility, whether it's Milton in America, Plato Papers, blah, blah. They all share a feeling for London as a city of eternity. As a symbol of timelessness. So characters may not reoccur in each street or in each area, but the same type of people emerge in the same type of neighborhoods. And I'm very well aware of the fact that there is a certain reciprocity of temperament and attitude amongst various people of London.
When we see London in the present day with this kind of with the Brexit, but also with this terrorist attacks and kind of a invisible wall that has been built, you know, we're leaving Europe in a way. Can you see in the history of London a safe moment in the past? Like,
oh yes, the moments like that have always been like that. It's always been a city of, well, how can I put it, of darkness, of threat, of danger, of a city where the alien or the stranger is not necessarily welcome. It's also been a city based upon money and power and greed. And these are all the qualities which London still manifests, as far as I can see.
You said that, well, there wouldn't be Shakespeare without London.
No, there wouldn't be a London without Shakespeare, probably.
London without Shakespeare. Can we transfer it to you? Could you be possible without London?
No, I couldn't. I live in London, it's my home. It's my city, it's my resting place, probably be my burial place too. And I can't imagine not living here.
Right, well, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.